Good afternoon, everyone. We come to the today's lecture series on forensic odontology in association with the INPEFO and Association of Forensic Odontology of Human Rights. And today's eminent speaker, I introduce Dr. Hemalatha Pandey. She's speaking on role of forensic odontology and dental anthropology in identification of human rights. She is an assistant professor in forensic odontology, the Department of Forensic Medicine and Toxicology at State GS Medical College and KEM Hospital in Mumbai. She is the first Indian to have established in the section for forensic odontology at the government hospital. She has completed BDS, MSc in forensic odontology from United Kingdom and diploma in forensic human identification from UK. She is also a PhD scholar and also pursuing her law degree. She is also trained in international humanitarian law and criminal justice system. She is the first in India to have been involved in DVI team as a forensic odontology and able to do the dental identification during DVI, where accessibility to dental records is a major concern, and involved in the four such DVI teams. And she conducts training for PhD offers as a first response for the humanitarian forensic action in disasters. She also involved in sensitive cases of serial killings, exhaustion of human remains, crimes against the children and valuable vulnerable people, and also expertise on request of the state police CBI in courts in India. Her areas of interest include the missing persons and unidentified human remains by dental anthropology, biological profiling of human remains by forensic facial approximation techniques. She conducts a training, lectures, hands-on workshops for dental and medical students. She is the chief faculty of Indian Board of Forensic Odontology, chief faculty forensic section of IDA, and faculty at several PG courses. She is the faculty of State Police Academy and also training police school in Maharashtra. She has been a guest speaker at various national and international conferences and CDE programs and various workshops. She is an executive member of Indian Association of Forensic Odontology, president-elect of 2020-21 Association Forensic Odontology of Human Rights, and a member of American Society of Forensic Odontology, and a member of INPEFO. She is also a TED speaker, a recipient of the Youngest Achiever Icon Award, and frequently appears in media regarding the forensic investigation in which she has been involved. Now, I'd like to introduce Dr. Hemalatha Pandey to continue her guest lecture.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to speak on the role of forensic odontology and dental anthropology in identification of human remains. So we have been having extensive sessions. We've already had 3 sessions. And you have heard a lot about identification and the role of teeth, the teeth play in this identification process. Let me just brush up in a slide that why identification is required. So the necessity, it can be classified broadly into 3 categories. One is for criminal investigations. As long as we don't know the identity of the dead body which is found, it is almost impossible to further investigate the case if you don't know who that person is. The family and friends, whom should we interview, how the person was killed, or why he was killed, the manner of death, all those. In fact, manner of death we can say by postmortem, but rest of the questions, it is very difficult to answer these questions without knowing the identity of the person. So most of these cases where the identity is still unknown, it's still a question, these cases end up being cold cases, and they end up being a closed file, that's it. Other reason is disaster. We already heard yesterday Dr. Evi Untoro. She spoke about disaster victim identification, and she spoke about the role dentists play in this. It is dentistry is a very major part of DVI process. Among other forensic specialists, such as the friction-rich pattern analysis, the DNA analysis, DNA fingerprinting. Dentistry is one among those. It is a primary form of identification as per the Interpol guidelines. Another reason is war crimes. So according to the Geneva Convention of 1949, they have dedicated the convention to the prisoners of wars, prisoners of these war crimes, conflicts, civilians who are involved in these war crimes for their protection and also amelioration. So according to the Article 17 of the Geneva Convention, it states that parties to the conflict shall ensure that burial or cremation of the dead is carried out individually as far as circumstances permit, is preceded by a careful examination, if possible by a medical examination of the bodies, with a view to confirming death, establishing identity, and enabling a report to be made. This also includes exhumation of remains, exhumation of mass graves for identifications of the deceased, and the repatriation to their families and their countries. Now, this is from the Interpol. Although this is from 1996, now we have now the Interpol has 194 countries, member countries. It recognizes that for legal, religious, cultural, and other reasons, human beings have the right to not to lose their identity after death. And the identification of victim is of importance for police investigation. And there is a protocol which exists between all member countries to a standard process of DVI in the event that they suffer fatalities within their country. So, Interpol recognizes that for legal, religious, and cultural reasons. So, even for the family, I mean, human rights, yes, for human rights and dignified management of the dead, identification is a vital process. But also for the family, the closure for the family, you know, if there is a dead body found which is unknown, unidentified, there is a family somewhere still looking for their loved ones. And we have heard stories where families wait for years, even decades, for their loved ones to come back because the identification has not been confirmed. So closure is a very important part of identification for the families of these victims. According to the Section 108 of Indian Evidence Act, a person is presumed to be dead who is unheard of for more than 7 years by those who would have naturally heard of him or her if he or she had been alive. So, if a person has been involved in an accident, that the person was involved and the person has not the family has not heard of him again after that incident, it would be presumed that he has died in that incident because he was involved. But the family needs to wait for 7 years for all the documentation and work to take place. So things such as life insurance, pensions, and all those monetary things, they cannot be moved forward if the identification is not confirmed scientifically. Now, I know that in India, I'm working in the department since over 7 years now, and this is the common thing among most, in fact, all I can say forensic departments. They identify, if there is an unknown body, the first thing they look for is if there is any scars on the body or any birthmarks on the body, if there are any moles, tattoos on the body. These are the first things they look for, and if they find something, then the body is identification is confirmed based on this. Fingerprints are recorded in cases where the body is not identifiable. DNA samples are taken. It's usually a tooth and a bone is kept for DNA analysis. And later on, if some family comes and claims it, for comparison, the DNA is taken from the biological relatives, such as the mother or the siblings or their children. implants or unique medical conditions are also a primary form of identification. It could be, hip implants, dental implants, pacemakers. These provide unique identity to the person. And of course, dental. But as far as I know, dental is the last thing. If nothing, is available, then maybe they go for dental comparison in India because there is inaccessibility to antemortem dental records. So a question is, why teeth? Why are teeth so important as primary identifiers? Main reason is that the teeth are highly resilient structures. They are among the strongest tissues in the human body. So they can resist high temperatures. They can resist time, as in we still find teeth in archaeological remains.
I cannot see the picture. Picture is hazy.
Sorry?
Picture is hazy.
Which
picture is not yes now yes
it's that slide, right? It's a background, it's not a picture.
Oh, I see.
So why teeth? Because teeth are resilient structures. They can survive time. We still find teeth in archaeological remains. They can survive being in water for a long time. They can survive animal predation. Animals, they will tend to chew on bones or eat bones and the soft tissue. Most of the times you will find that the teeth are left behind. They can survive high and low temperatures. So teeth are very high, resilient structures. Along with that, a very practical advantage is that it is very cheap to do dental identification as compared to DNA, because DNA identification by DNA fingerprinting can be quite expensive process, and it is a very sensitive process as well. DNA is highly susceptible to contamination. DNA samples, if not preserved properly and if not handled properly, can be easily contaminated, and the chain of custody can be questioned. With dental identification, it is a little easier comparatively, and it just takes a couple of hundred Indian rupees, I can say, for using dental ID for confirming the identity of a person. So it is quick, cheap, easy, and a reliable method as compared to other techniques. Also, for anything to be used as a primary identifier, it has to fulfill certain criteria. So like fingerprints and DNA, our dental pattern is unique to us. So the set of teeth present in my mouth cannot be present in someone else's mouth. The patterns, the shapes, the size, the various, if there is some kind of caries or fillings and any kind of dental treatment, it makes it unique to me. So it's just like fingerprints, it is unique to you. That is the reason why it is used. Also, another reason is if one expert does a dental ID and another expert does the dental ID, they should come to the same conclusion. It is like fingerprints and DNA. Two people cannot have different opinions for it to be a primary identification technique. So, or if I do the identification today and if I do the same case again after 5 years, I should be able to come to the same conclusion following the standard steps or the standard technique. So this is what makes it a primary identifier. A very popular definition of forensic dentistry has been given by Kaiser and Nielsen. According to them, it is a branch of forensic dentistry that, in interest of justice, deals with proper handling and examination of dental evidence and the proper evaluation and presentation of dental findings. So they deal with the dental part of it and the legal part of it in the definition. I feel that the points which are mentioned under that should also are a very big part of forensic odontology. So first of all, identification of dental remains, of dental evidence. So if there is dental evidence in that particular case, which can be used for forensic investigation, if it is not identified that there is a dental evidence which can be used, then there is no point of it being there. there is no value to it if it is not identified. Because normally, in 99% of the cases, forensic odontologist will not be the first person to examine the remains or to examine the case. It will normally be a medical officer or a forensic pathologist or forensic medicine person or a police officer who will be seeing the body and who will be the first person who will be checking if there is any kind of evidence present. So if that first person, he doesn't recognize that there is a need, there is some kind of dental evidence available and we should call a forensic odontologist or we should refer it to a forensic odontologist, then if that person doesn't recognize, then the value of that evidence is zero. So first person should be able to identify and refer the case to a forensic odontologist. So I think identification that there is some kind of dental evidence is a very important part. Then we go for collection, preservation, transportation, storage, handling, analysis, report. And report is not the last step. Presentation of that report in court is the last step, because as long as you don't defend your report, it is not acceptable evidence. So you have to defend it against cross-examination, which is the last step of your case. So presentation of evidence is also very important. Now, this is from the Interpol guidelines. I'm not going into detail because yesterday Dr. Evi already has covered this part. According to the Interpol, we have four stages to accurately identify a victim in a DVI situation, which is also, you can say, applicable for a single case of a dead body. So first is the scene examination. In cases of DVI, this can take days, weeks, or even months to collect all the victim, all the deceased, and to collect all the property of all the victims. It can take days. Postmortem, the collection of postmortem data, which includes fingerprints, odontology, and DNA profiling. Fingerprints may not always be available, especially if it is there is incineration or charring of the body, or when the body is in advanced stages of decomposition, it might not be possible all the time. DNA profiling, again, it needs, as I said, sensitive. It is sensitive to the technique. Also, if there are charred remains, I have personally seen many cases where it is inconclusive when they collect for DNA sample, and if it is a charred remain, the lab normally reports that it's inconclusive and they are unable to extract DNA. So odontology can help in such cases. Physical indicators, if there are any unique medical records, as I showed earlier, that can also be useful. Visual identification is not considered to be accurate. If the body is fresh and intact, it could be shown to the next of kin, but it cannot be considered as a primary form of identification. It can only be a circumstantial evidence. Third is the antemortem data collection, which is another team which speaks to the families of the missing person, or a family which is claiming that the dead body is their loved one. We speak to them and collect whatever data is available from them. As an odontologist, we ask about any kind of dental treatments, any kind of dental records. We will cover that in the next slide. And last is reconciliation, when we compare the data of the postmortem and the antemortem findings, and we make a decision as to whether it belongs to this person or it doesn't. Now, classification of dental remains. They have been broadly classified into three categories. One is class one, fresh remains. It could be whole remains or fragmented remains. Sometimes when a person is involved in a high impact accident, the remains could be fresh, like in a car accident or a train wreck, the remains could still be fresh, but they could be fragmented. So that comes under class one. Then we have decomposed or incinerated remains, which again further subcategory into whole and fragmented. And we have skeletal remains, which are again whole and fragmented remains. Fragmented skeletal remains are normally a result of animal predation or a secondary crime scene where a body is moved later on. So any kind of identification is not just dental. It will require comparison of two data sets. That is the reason sometimes even fingerprint identification becomes difficult, because not everyone has their fingerprints on records. Now there is a different issue of Aadhaar in India. We can discuss that in the end. But for the purpose of criminal investigations, not everyone has their fingerprints in records, because of which it becomes difficult to do comparative identification. As compared to that, many people have gone to dentists and they may have dental records. That is the reason why it is accessible. Comparative identification. Now, this is the DVI form, which even Dr. Evi showed you yesterday. Let us just see the dental part in detail. I'm not covering the whole form. We'll just have a look at the dental part. So the yellow form is the antemortem form. You can see on the top left corner, it says antemortem yellow. You can see the sections. You have family name. So these findings we are taking from the family which is claiming that body. Okay, so we have the family name, first name, the unique antemortem number given to that case, date of birth of that person, age, male, female, and if the other unknown. So we will fill in these findings from the family. And when the family presents with the dental records, they may have written notes. They may have the OPD file. They may have radiographs. It could be periapical radiographs, bite wings, occlusals, or OPGs. So they may have these. Nowadays, dentists have started taking before and after photographs. So even that may be included in the records. So you may have photographs. So all these records are used to fill in this odontogram or this chart. You can see that every tooth, it shows with five surfaces. So you have the occlusal surface or the incisal surface. You have the proximal, mesial and distal surfaces. You have the buccal surface and the lingual surface or the palatal surface. And you have all the teeth. Now the nomenclature used for this chart is the FDI nomenclature. Next section, you have the dental images available. So if there are any kind of radiographs available, you have periapicals, PA, bite wings, OPGs, if there are any CT scans available, and other radiographs or photographs. And they can be digital or non-digital with their unique number. If you have any further material present, further material could include the dental casts or study casts. It could include retainers, dentures, complete or partial. It could include so many number of mouth guards or sports mouth guards, bleaching trays. That could all come under the further material. In the last bottom section, you see that the information is collected by the duty title, name, address, phone, email, and signature. So this would be the forensic odontologist who is collecting the information. And this is the next, we have this, if there is any specific data related, if there are any crowns, pontics, implants, dentures, any processes in the person's dental records, other findings regarding occlusion, tooth wear, periodontal status, supernumerary and stains. So these are findings which are only, most of the dentists, if it is only out of the ordinary, they will record these things. Type of dentition, whether it is a primary, mixed or permanent dentition. So primary dentition is the deciduous teeth or what is called as a milk teeth in children. Then we have mixed dentition, which is the transition. So the child or the adolescent, they may have mix some primary teeth and some permanent teeth. And permanent teeth is the adult dentition, which is normally after the age of 12 to 14, where we have all the adult teeth present, permanent teeth present in the mouth. quality check. So it is always recommended, in fact it is a must for the, according to the Interpol guidelines, to at least have two forensic odontologists working on one case. So you know, you can watch your back, one person can see the findings, the other person can record it, and then they can do a cross check, vice versa, and then in the end again collected by whom. And there is an extra page. If there is any kind of extra information available, it can be entered on the extra page. Now, this is a postmortem or the pink form. You can see in the left upper corner, it says PM, postmortem pink. The place of disaster, nature of disaster, the unique PM number to that body. It may not always be a complete body, so it might be the fragmented remains, so the unique number of that body bag. Date of disaster, male, female, other or unknown. What is the material present? So the remains, jaws with teeth, upper and lower, jaws without teeth, upper and lower, teeth only, so the number, FDI number of all the teeth present. And if there is a fragment, the details about the fragments. Then you have, then you have dental images available. Again, what kind of dental radiographs the postmortem team has taken. So periapicals, bite rings, OPGs, CT scans, other radiographs and photographs, and whether they are digital or non-digital. Supplementary details include the condition of the body. So whether you saw in the classification earlier, whether it is a whole, fragmented, decomposing, skeletonized, what is the condition of the body and other details. Then you have the chart similar as how we recorded for the antemortem from the dental records. In the postmortem, we actually examine the deceased and we do a complete oral examination and we record the findings on this odontogram. So this will be a more complete record as you are not relying on some other dental practitioners' records. Then similarly, we fill all the findings from the dead bodies. If there are any prostheses, crowns, pontics, implants, dentures, or any other prostheses. If there is any specific finding related to the occlusion, tooth wear, periodontal status, numeraries, stains, and others. The type of dentition. Estimated age. And we all know that dental age can be estimated based on the radiograph or the dental examination, or if there is a extracted tooth or a tooth which has come out loose, we can also do age estimation on that. So the age estimation, which is dental age, minimum and maximum year and month, and then the two forensic odontologists who are examining the body. And also we have a supplement page for if there is any extra information which is relevant and which could be useful to the case. So what are the requirements, minimum requirements of a dental identification? One is lack of adequate recording of dental status at a fixed point in time. So there are dentists who will normally just write the treatment which they are doing. They may not record all the findings. So if they are doing a filling or a root canal treatment on one particular tooth, they will just mention that on that date. They will not do a full record. Lack of uniformity in charting and tooth numbering systems. Or dentists in different countries, they may use different nomenclature. In fact, even in one country itself, different regions, they may use different nomenclatures. I know this being a dentist, that in India itself, in different cities, they use different nomenclatures. Also depends on where they have graduated from and where they have learned to make those records. So that influences the numbering systems used. Inadequate dental radiographs. So the dental radiographs may just be a periapical radiograph because some treatment is being done on that radiograph. Sometimes the quality of the dental radiograph will not be very good. If it is a manually developed radiograph, it depends on the kind of chemicals used, whether it was old chemicals, whether the composition is correct, whether you know the time of exposure is correct. All those things affect the quality of the dental radiographs. Illegible dental records. Sometimes it would be the dental assistant or the hygienist who may record dental findings. And the dentist himself later on, if shown the records, might not be able to read the handwriting, or the forensic odontologist might not be able to read the dentist's handwriting. So this is a practical problem which is faced during dental IDs. And the dynamic state of dentition, because it is changing, you know, the increase in caries. Sometimes, in some cases, researchers have also, they have published decrease in incipient caries. So it is a dynamic state and it keeps on changing. So we have to be very careful if we are using old dental records, especially for ID. Now, this is a problem we face in India, and I'm sure in many other developing countries, because the records are not centralized or it is not under one particular database. Everyone goes to a private dentist and the records may not always be available. In fact, one patient may go to three or four different dentists. For example, he may go to one dentist for a filling. He might still have pain and go to a second dentist for a root canal treatment, and the family has no idea. So in such cases, it is difficult to get dental records. And nowadays, with the everyone having a cell phone in their hand, having two cameras in their front camera, back camera, selfies, all those things, it is very easy to access photographs where teeth are visible, the person is smiling and teeth are visible, which are also a very rich source of dental antemortem dental information. So if we have anterior teeth visible, now this picture, the lady in the picture, it's not a digital photograph, it's a manual photograph which has been scanned. So it may look a little blurry to you, but in this photograph we were able to identify just based on this photograph, because there is a spacing, the incisal edges, everything can be seen clearly. And the lower incisor is missing post-mortem. You can see the socket is open, so it is missing post-mortem. Now, high impact accidents, the unique structure and traits of human teeth and jaws readily lend themselves to victim identification, and teeth are virtually indestructible over time. In the event of a violent death, such as plane crash or explosions, train wrecks, bodies are subjected to considerable energies and fire. The teeth are well protected in the oral cavity and are able to withstand many external influences at, near, or after the time of death. They are, this we discussed already, teeth are hardest and most resilient substances in the body. So the body's soft tissue deteriorate. The dental characteristics that are so valuable for identification purposes remain accessible. This is especially true of treatments in the teeth, such as fillings and crowns. Even when crowns are destroyed, the maxillary bone protects the root, which can provide important information. Now, this is a case of a high impact accident. You can see the body has been charred. Based on the smiling, the teeth are still intact and they are well preserved, in fact. And based on the smiling photograph, the identification was confirmed. However, in most cases where it is a very high impact explosion or like an aeroplane crash, in such cases the anterior teeth may sometimes be fractured or fragmented. You can see in this picture the enamel has been chipped off, and you can see the dentine, which is the yellowish brown in color now because of the incineration. So anterior teeth may not always be preserved. However, the posterior teeth, owing to the buccal fat pad in the cheeks, they are well preserved, which can be used for identification if there is some kind of filling or dental treatment done. So posterior teeth, you can see, are still intact in this case. Now, sometimes when the jaw opening is difficult, or if the body is in rigor and we need to do the dental examination at that time, we can in some textbooks I have read, they recommend jaw resection. However, we don't do jaw resections anymore, and we don't damage the body or, you know, or make it not viewable for further ID. So what we do in fact is, instead of resecting the jaw, we raise a flap, we take a Y-shaped incision, which can then be continued into the postmortem examination by the medical officer. So a Y-shaped incision can be raised and the teeth can be examined, and it can later on be sutured back. So this is a very easy technique. This is a example of jaw resection which is not done anymore. Earlier they used to do jaw resections also because portable radiographs were not an option at that time, and so they used to resect the jaws and take it for radiography in the radiology department. However, now we can take portable radiographs in the mortuary itself, so we don't need to resect the jaw out. This is a paper I read regarding how teeth, restored teeth can withstand incineration. You can see on the first left corner, the restored teeth with amalgam filling, it is subjected to 200 degrees Celsius. Amalgam shows an alteration of the marginal seal and loss of brightness. So mercury starts evaporating, so there is a loss of brightness and it becomes darker in color. Restored teeth with amalgam filling, second one in the middle, subjected to 400, bubbles in amalgam, marginal contraction of amalgam and fissures of the enamel. So the bubbles are because there is evaporation of the mercury, and which later on cools down and it looks like bubbles. The third one is the restored teeth with amalgam filling, subjected to 800 degrees Celsius, contraction and cracks in the amalgam filling. You can see that the shape of the filling is still intact, even though there is a cracks and bubbles appearing. Restored teeth with amalgam filling, subjected to 1000 degrees Celsius, cracks of the enamel, silver bullets and contractions in amalgam filling. So, up to in this study, it was shown that up to 1000 to 1200 degrees Celsius, restored teeth can withstand such high temperatures, and they can still be used for dental identification purposes. Now, a role of a dentist. Many dentists ask me that I want to do forensic odontology, but I feel scared or I feel dirty of looking at a dead body or working on a dead body. So for such dentists, they can play the role of forensic odontologist being a clean odontologist. So maintaining of complete records of existing conditions, chart all existing restorations and unusual conditions, note missing unerupted and supernumerary teeth, add all restorations including the material which was used for restoring, and maintain the records indefinitely, which is possible now because everyone maintains digital records. People have stopped maintaining hard copies or files of the dental records, so digitally they can be stored indefinitely. Role of a forensic odontologist is again similar but on the dead body. So you maintain complete record of the existing conditions, chart all existing restorations, note missing unerupted and supernumerary teeth, chart all new restoration including materials, maintain records indefinitely using digital systems. Now, it is always preferable that we work in a team, because working alone on a dead body is very difficult and you become more susceptible to mistakes. So if you are in a team, you can have someone shoot the x-ray, locators who can set the recording film or sensor, and a recorder who can fill out the chart with a pen and a paper, and a photographer if possible. Now, these team members need not necessarily be forensic odontologists themselves. So they can be dental hygienists, they can be dental assistants, or they can be, if it is a multidisciplinary team, they can be people, forensic medical examiners or assistants of forensic medical examiners. So anyone working or anyone who is an autopsy personnel can help out in this team for shooting, photographing and taking radiographs. So always preferable to work in a team. Now, conclusions which are possible when you are doing comparative identification, these are the five conclusions you can come to. This is based on the Interpol guidelines again. So, identification is absolutely certain. The antemortem and postmortem records are from the same person. You are completely certain. Identification is probable. Specific characteristics correspond between antemortem and postmortem, but either antemortem or postmortem data are both or both are minimal. Identification is possible. There is nothing that excludes the identity. So there is no discrepancy or unexplainable discrepancy between the antemortem and postmortem data. Identity is excluded, which is another form of positive identification, as in you say that it is definitely not this person. You're coming to a definite conclusion anyways. Insufficient evidence when there is a lack of antemortem or postmortem record, the evidence is insufficient to come to a conclusion. So these are the five conclusions available to a forensic odontologist. Now, anthropology. Anthropology is a branch of it's a field of that utilizes information. I'm talking about dental anthropology, obtained from the teeth of either skeletal or modern human populations to resolve anthropological problems. The reason teeth play a very important part in anthropology is because teeth can be studied in modern populations as well as in archaeological remains. So people who are living, yet still alive, their teeth can be observed just by intraoral examination. And the teeth of archaeological remains also can be observed. Whereas you cannot say the same for the skeletal or the bones. So dental anthropology plays a very major part in reconstructive identification or biological profiling. So a biological profiling is because not all the time the police knows that who this dead body could belong to, and there is no one to claim that dead body, or there is no missing person reported. So in those cases, the police can go for reconstructive identification or a biological profiling, wherein they construct an profile of that deceased person by saying that this person is of this particular age range, he is a male or a female, the race of the person, the stature of the person, the race or ethnicity, the stature of that person, and other findings. If there are any unique findings related to his habits or any pathological conditions based on the skeletal examination. So they make a biological profile of that person. The role of forensic anthropologists, it includes skeletal examination of the skeletal anatomy, including differentiating between human and non-human bones. I remember seeing a presentation regarding London bombings in the tube, where they had forensic anthropologists in their team because they wanted to differentiate between human and non-human bones, especially bones of the rats and rodents, because it was in the underground tube. So they had a lot of commingled animal bones, bones belonging to rats, humans, flesh from people's lunch boxes, because they had chicken and meat in their lunch boxes. So differentiate between that flesh and human flesh. So they had forensic anthropologists in their team for that case. Managing collection of commingled human remains, skeletal trauma analysis, infrequently relevant for identification, managing compromised remains. Taphonomy is also a very important part of forensics, wherein we distinguish between the antemortem, perimortem, and postmortem alteration in bones. So if the body has been lying in one particular environment for a very long time, that will influence the decomposition, and that will influence any alteration in that body. So if, for example, the pH of the soil or the chemical composition of the soil or the kind of water that person has been, the dead body has been lying in, it will influence, it may cause discoloration of the bones, it may cause discoloration of the teeth. So that comes under forensic taphonomy, and anthropologists are very well versed with the detailed analysis of this subject. Anatomic features which may aid identification. So let us quickly look at how dentists or how forensic odontologists can play a part in the anthropology. So one is sex determination. Now sex determination by teeth, we will see a lot of research papers on this subject where people have attempted to determine sex based on teeth, and a general consensus is that female teeth, the size is comparatively smaller in general as compared to the male teeth. However, this is not a reliable technique to confirm the sex of a person. It can be unreliable, especially if just one body is found and one skeletal remain is found, and to compare and to say that it is bigger or small, the size of teeth is bigger or smaller, is not easy. So sex determination by teeth cannot be a reliable technique, or we cannot use to confirm, but it can definitely be a circumstantial evidence. Age estimation by teeth. The age estimation is widely done with the help of teeth. It is a part of all age estimation reports. Stature estimation by teeth. Again, this has been done by many researchers where they try to estimate stature of teeth, especially based on the canine to canine distance or the mesiodistal diameter from canine to canine. So stature has been estimated using teeth. However, again, it is not as accurate as the long bones. Long bones are more accurate for estimating stature, and they are regularly used for stature estimation in anthropological remains. Race determination, ethnicity. Yes, there are some findings on the teeth which can help us estimate the race of the person or determine the race of the person. So that teeth can be helpful for race determination. Socioeconomic status, again, the kind of dental treatments which have been done, the quality of the material or the kind of material which has been used. Many times, especially in more developing countries, even in India, we see many tooth doctors who are not actually dentists. So they do dental treatments, or they will do work without having a license or without having the proper qualification. So it somehow it can help us, or it can guide us towards what kind of socioeconomic status that person comes from to be able to go to a qualified dentist, or if there are some good quality dental implants or fillings, we know that we can have an idea regarding the socioeconomic status of that person. Now, quickly, based on skull, there are many features on the skull. In fact, a study done by Bukistra and Willaker, they have said that if you have the pelvis of the skeleton, you can say by 95% accuracy whether it is a male or a female by examining adult pelvis. If you have a skull, you can be 90% accurate whether it is male or female. And if you have both skull and pelvis, you can be 98% accurate whether it is a male or a female. So skull plays a very important part in sex determination. There are several features on the skull, such as the glabella, which is more robust in men as compared to females, where it is a little flatter. Then we have the edges, the frontal eminence of the orbits, which is sharper in females. It is more rounded and robust in males. The mastoid process, if you see the mastoid process, it is slightly longer and thicker in males. It is shorter in females and thinner. The mastoid process just behind the external auditory meatus. You also see that the extension of the zygomatic process, it says that it extends beyond the external auditory meatus in males, and whereas it extends till up to the external auditory meatus in females. Now, then we have the nuchal crest, which is more notched and sharp in men. In females, it is slightly flatter. And you have the sloping of the frontal bone, and so many features on the skull. Also on the mandible, you can say the angle of mandible, which is more obtuse in females, whereas it is sharper in males. So all these features help us estimate the sex of the person based on skull. For dental age in itself is a very broad topic, and it can take days to discuss this subject. However, I'll just quickly in one slide say that there are several techniques for dental age estimation, which are broadly categorized into the ATLAS method. There are several atlases by Schaar and Messler, the London Atlas, which are commonly used for age estimation. However, there are certain limitations, like these atlases can be used only when the teeth are developing, and once the complete dentition complex has developed, the atlas cannot be used anymore. Again, radiographs can be used for children, for the atlas method, and radiographs can be used for adolescents or children, teenagers in the age range of say 14 to 21, with methods such as the Demergian and the modified Demergian method, wherein not just the eruption but the mineralization of the tooth is observed in the radiograph, which is divided into stages, and there is a score for every stage which is put in a formula, and the age can be estimated. Radiographs can be used in adults once the mineralization of all teeth has been completed. In adults, we can use radiograph for a technique called as the pulp tooth ratio technique, because it is a fact that the pulp chamber, it shrinks because of the secondary dentine deposition. With age, the pulp chamber starts shrinking. So what we do is we take a ratio of the tooth and we take a ratio of the pulp to the tooth, and we put that ratio in a formula to get an age. So this technique is used for adults. Histological methods can only be used in deceased, so because we need extracted tooth for histological age estimation, we can use techniques such as the root dentine translucency, wherein the roots start becoming translucent from the apex upwards with age, and the length of or the area of this translucency is put in a formula to determine age of that person. However, this can only be done on a extracted or a loose tooth, so it has to be done only in dead people. You cannot extract, it is unethical to extract a living person's tooth for age estimation. So for living people, we prefer radiological techniques. It has to be said, you know. So morphological methods, again, we have several methods which use the eruption sequence and all those things for age estimations, which is normally done by every dentist or every pediatric dentist to determine the treatment plan and all those things. Now, just quickly, a few things on the skull regarding race determination. So you can see the nasal spine, which is in Caucasians, it is sharp and prominent. In Negroids, you can say it is very small and almost not there in some cases. In Mongoloids, it is said that it is rounded and small. Nasal ceiling, the arrow on the left picture, you can see there is a sharp edge, so there, which is called as a nasal ceiling. It is seen in Caucasian people. The guttering, which is seen on the left side, you can see there where the black arrows are, it is sloping. There is no edge, so it is just sloping downwards. It is seen in Negroids population. Prognathism is more prominent in Negroids. And the shape of orbital openings, it is rectangular or squarish in Negroids, whereas it is roundish and squarish in Caucasians. Now, this is all I'm saying from the literature, which is already available since already available on all the platforms. So it is not something unique which I'm saying. It is already available all this literature. Shoveling, it is a very unique characteristic seen in Asians and Native Americans. A large population in Asia have shoveling of teeth, whereas the shoveling is very slight or in the Caucasians. It is present but very slight in the European population. It is almost not present or absent in the Negroid population. Now, this is just a formula I saw from this article by Claria. They have given stature estimation based on the tooth dimensions. Now, other factors which can help us in making a profile of the person are, we can say regarding the dietary habits of the person, if they consume a lot of acid, sodas, or you know these drinks, it can lead to erosion of the teeth, psychological problem if they have some stressful teeth grinding habits like bruxism, occupational habits, tailors or carpenters, they have a habit of keeping a needle or a nail in between their teeth. So that can produce notching if it is done for a long time, for longer periods of time. Medical problems, if someone has a gastroesophageal reflex, it can cause erosion of the teeth, or bulimia. In those cases, it can lead to erosion of the teeth. Previous illnesses, if there was a tetracycline staining, it can be visible during, if the person had tetracycline treatment during their developing years, it can lead to staining of the teeth. Fluorosis, again, children who may consume toothpaste which has fluoride, they can have fluorosis. But in India, we have seen that it is more common in villages where naturally the fluoride level is high in the water. According to WHO, the acceptable fluoride level is 1.5 ppm parts per million of fluoride, whereas in India there are places where it is up to 45 parts per million. And in fact, some ingredients such as rock salt, which is commonly used in food preparation, rock salt, it has a more than 100 ppm of fluoride in it. So it is quite common, fluorosis in India. I'll show you an example. On the bottom, the two pictures you see, on the left is a mild fluorosis where you can see mottling, and on the right side in the bottom you can see severe fluorosis. Okay, on the top right is the tetracycline stain. This one is a tetracycline staining, and this over here, staining is by tobacco, which is again very common in our region. So, tobacco staining. This is by bulimia. You can see there is erosion of the teeth from palatal surface is eroded, and there is thinning. We have grinding or bruxism. You can see it is attrited with the surface. This I saw from a paper, anthropology related paper. You can see over here, this is because of a pipe smoking. It's a facet developed because of the pipe, because they hold a pipe like this for a very long time. So they have this facet developed over here from pipe smoking. Again, traffic police who hold a whistle in their mouth for a longer periods of time, or carpenters holding nails in their mouth, or tailors holding needles in their mouth, that can lead to notching of teeth. So all these things help us. It is, you can say, occupational. It can help us in determining occupation or making a profile of that person. This is also from one anthropology paper which I found. So you can see there is a distinctive pattern of labial rounding over here. It indicates use of working with the skin for a long period of time, or leather for a long period of time. Now I'll just finish with this because it was mentioned. Another way forensic odontologist or forensic artists can help the police is by approximation techniques such as superimposition and reconstruction of the facial features. Now, this is not a confirmatory technique for identification, so we cannot expect that just based on this, the person will be identified. This is only used when the case is has gone cold, there are no further clues, and we help the police in reconstructing the face, and then they circulate that image in among the people of that region, and if someone can identify that person based on that reconstruction, the final identification is confirmed based on DNA or other primary methods. So this is just a method used when the case has gone cold and to further the investigation. It is not a primary technique of identification. So this is one of the examples where we received a skull in advanced stages of decomposition. You can see the whitish or greenish part on the mandible is the fungal growth. There was maggots, and overall the skull is almost partially skeletonized. So the first step is we do maceration, we clean the skull. It takes several days for us to clean the skull. Maceration can be done by various methods. We can use chemicals, or we can just bury the skull and let it naturally macerate with the maggots and everything, which takes a longer period of time. Or we can just clean it in hot water, which the method which I have used. So we macerated the skull and we cleaned it for reconstruction. We make a duplicate model of the skull. Normally if the skull is intact and we know that it will not be fractured if we take an impression, we will always prefer reconstructing the skull on a duplicate or on a cast. So we take an impression and make a cast, and we reconstructed the face. This case was cold for about 8 months, where there was no clue. The body head was found about 10 meters away from the body, and it was during the summer, so it was in advanced stages of decomposition. So it was lying cold for about 8 months. We thought, why not try? So we tried reconstructing the face in this case. Later on, this photograph of the reconstructed face was circulated in that region where the body was found. And in 3 days, one of the informers, they told police that someone has identified this man as a driver of a machine who used to work in a construction site. And he has not come to work since about 9 or 10 months. So the police then traced his address, and when they went to his home, there was his wife and 2 children living there. When they questioned the wife, she said that he has gone to another city for work and he sends us money regularly. Even the children said the same thing, that father sends us money, he has gone somewhere else to work. When the police tried tracing that other city, they found nothing. It was a cold, there was nothing over there. So they came back to his wife and they examined her again. They interviewed her again when she confessed that she had an affair and her boyfriend had murdered her husband. And they had actually used a blade to remove the skin from the face so that it would not be identified. So you can see that although it's not exactly the same, but if someone knows that person when they were alive, they may recognize him by looking at that reconstructed face. They may say that, oh yeah, he is looking like him, a little bit like him. He's not here. He's missing since so many months. So, and later on, the identification was confirmed. We did a DNA comparison based on the sternum and teeth of this skeletal remains. We compared it to the brother of that missing man, and it matched. So approximation methods can be used if the investigation is stuck and the police has needs some clue to further the investigation. So this is the case. This thing I want to just to all the young, especially forensic students, that we should be aware of the limitations of our science and the unrealistic expectations which are set by TV and media on forensics. We should be able to educate people regarding this, because I have noticed that many times lawyers and even the judges in some cases, they have unrealistic expectations from us. They are not aware regarding the limitations of the science and highly influenced by what is shown in the media. So we have to be very careful of this and always work in a team, multidisciplinary team, especially forensic odontologists. We are always part of a team. And if there are skeletal remains, anthropologists, we might not have any forensic anthropologist available easily here in India. They might not be available. So we always take help from anatomist if there is a skeletal remains found. So we have forensic medicine people, or forensic pathologists, forensic anatomist or anthropologist, and forensic odontologist working together, always in a team. Thank you for listening so patiently.
So there is one question from Muskan Soni. She wants to know how we can determine the age from teeth.
So this question was asked at 120. I think I covered a little bit after that. So because age estimation is a very huge topic and it can take days to discuss. But teeth in the developing years. So when a child is developing, we can estimate age based on the stage of, you know, which tooth has erupted or which tooth is still developing in the jaw. We can take a X-ray or a radiograph and check which tooth has developed up to which stage, and we can estimate age of the person based on standard techniques which have been accepted in the scientific community. In adults, we can estimate age based on the deterioration process. So once a person has reached complete growth, the deterioration starts. So we estimate age based on those stages. So age can be estimated in children as well as adults based on teeth.
Pooja wants to ask, what according to you is the strength of forensic odontology as compared to the other forensic field?
We cannot really compare forensic odontology or any one field to another field. Everyone is equally important. We cannot compare that, no, we are, you know, number one or number two or number three. We are all equally important based on what kind of case it is. So if it is a case where only we can do fingerprints, then the fingerprint expert is the most important person and everyone needs to listen to him. If it is a case involving some where we need to determine cause, time, manner of death, the forensic pathologist is the most important person. So it depends on a case-to-case basis and we are all equally important. However, I see that you asked about bite marks. I want to just say that bite marks can be of very limited use. So unless we should not really stress on it a lot, because bite marks are very, they are opinions. As I said earlier, in dental identification, if two people are doing the same examination, they should come to the same conclusion because it's a primary technique of identifying. However, with bite marks, it is an opinion. It's a for an expert opinion. So I may say that, it is not this particular person, or we can exclude this particular person, whereas another expert might say that it is insufficient evidence, I can't say anything. So because it is our expert opinion, it is influenced by our experience, how long we have worked in the field, how many bite mark cases we have done. Someone who is doing it for the first time may have a different opinion than someone who has already done 100 cases. So bite marks, you cannot compare it with dental identification. Dental identification is a much more robust and primary form of forensic evidence.
Yeah, Professor Goria wants to ask one question. Sir, over to you.
Hello. Thanks for the very wonderful, exhaustive lecture. I just have two questions to you. And the first one is in your identification, and second part, the forensic anthropology. The first part of my question is, what do you think is the level of the awareness in the police, in the forensic pathologists all over India, not the metro cities, that forensic odontology should be used, because the identification is the prime responsibility of the police. And in 95% of the cases, they do the visual identification, and then they go for the fingerprints, and then probably they go in the last for the DNA one, but forensic dentistry is not being properly utilized because I don't know, because they don't have that much awareness. What do you think the level of awareness is amongst the forensic pathologists and the police to use the forensic odontology for the identification purposes? The second part of my question is in the forensic anthropology and therefore the gender determination, the teeth can be useful, and of course, ultimate is the DNA, but that being very costly, as told by you, cannot we use the bar bodies and bi bodies, because that is cheaper and easy to do for the gender determination? To you, Madam Hemlata. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the question. For your first question, sir, I totally agree with you. There is very less awareness regarding forensic odontology. In fact, sometimes when I go to more interiors or rural places, they are shocked to see a dentist. They say, why have you come? What is a dentist doing here? Like, it's there is very less awareness. But however, it is up to us now as forensic professionals, as people who are interested in this field, it is up to us to spread awareness. Because of this, I regularly conduct lectures for police academies and police training schools, because I feel that because they are the first point of contact, if they know that we can do dental ID, then it will be used. If they don't know, as you said, you know, they go for any visual identification and scars and marks. I have seen where even in bodies which have started decomposing, they have still done visual identification. So, visual identification is the first go-to, as far as my experience I have seen. Then they look for any scars, tattoos, etc. And otherwise, they'll keep fingerprints and DNA. They keep a sample teeth and some bone they will keep for identification. So, teeth is rarely used, only if the medical officer or the forensic pathologist or forensic medical person knows that teeth can be used. And there is some unique finding which is very obvious and noticeable to them. Then they will be used. So I think awareness is the first thing we should be doing in our country, sir, including medical officers and police officers. Sir, second part of your question, I agree with you again. I'm sorry, it skipped my mind. I should have had a slide about it. Yes, we can use bar bodies and comparatively easier than DNA to do sex determination with teeth. Yes, what I spoke was about morphological findings, how people have used anthropometry to say that based on the mesiodistal dimension, we can say it is male or female, which is not reliable. So, sorry, it skipped my mind. I should have spoken about the bar bodies and sex determinations.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hemlata. It is not missing. You did a lot of good things. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So, next question is from Shraddha Malik. Is it only a forensic odontologist who collect the antemortem data, or any other professional is also authorized?
It could be a dental hygienist or a dental assistant, because I feel that for collecting antemortem data, you should have knowledge about dentistry. At least the basics you should be knowing. You should be knowing about things which can be useful, because it's not just the dental records from the dental clinic. There are so many other things which can be used. Like I discussed earlier, the study cars, study models, retainers, guards, bleaching trays, all those things can be useful. So I think a person who at least have some basic training in dentistry, not necessarily an odontologist, but always preferable an odontologist. But if he's not available, then of course someone who has some basic training in dentistry, like a dental assistant or a dental hygienist, or even any dental practitioner or dentist from any field, they can collect AM data.
Yeah, the continuing question was asked by Poonam. If we don't have any previous data, like a scan or a structure of the teeth, then how could forensic odontology is significant?
So, which is very common in India, where we don't have many times antemortem dental records because it is not preserved. Sometimes some dentists keep it with themselves, some dentists hand it over to the patient. So, there is no standard procedure which people follow. It is difficult to get antemortem records. in such cases, I have found it very easy to use selfies and smiling photographs where teeth are visible. Most of the times, teeth are visible premolar to premolar, and sometimes canine to canine. So, if there are unique findings, and many times there are some kind of unique findings, there is rotation, there is spacing, there is chipping, there is attrition, fractures, all those things, it makes it unique, that smile, which helps us in identifying. So, even if you don't have dental records, we can still use forensic odontology for identification.
Yeah, Mansi wants to know that does the overall procedure in terms of forensic aspect differ from the deciduous and the permanent teeth?
The overall procedure should not differ. However, we should be aware that if we have records from a person's childhood or when his teeth were deceased, and if a few years have passed, because the dentition, this complex, it changes very fast in those developing years. So we have to be very careful on what points we are basing the identification.
Yeah, Jan Bikar wants to want, are there any specific dental features seen in the contemporary Indian population, such as dental modification or the traditional cultural region, jewelry or habits? And could they be used, for example, to estimate the region where the person came from, dental profiling? Question was asked at 1:30.
Yes. There are some tribal people who have dental modifications done to them, which are not like orthodontic modifications, which are not intended for any treatment purposes. So they are just aesthetic modifications done to their teeth. It can be filing of teeth. It can be sticking of the jewelry or stones on the tooth. So tribal populations and also Banjara ko kya bolte hain?
Countryside.
Nomads.
Yeah, nomads. These people, they may have dental modifications in their teeth, and we can tell the region of this person if you have such a body. However, I feel that it requires detailed study and not just a guessing game, because I'm being honest, I myself have not researched this in very detail about the different modifications in different regions. It is important and I much relevant topic, and it should be researched. Only if it is researched properly, then can we apply it for a forensic case. But yes, there are definitely certain cultures and certain regions where we can see these dental modifications in their teeth.
Yes, there are many questions. A few I tried to reply privately to them. So one again question, in many cases dentist only took x-ray or scan record for that specific teeth. So we are having a problem, how forensic odontology can help in this condition?
Okay, so if there is just like a periapical radiograph, only in that region you have just 3 or 4 teeth visible. So which is most of the cases, dentist will normally take a record on a radiograph of only that region. So in such cases, we can still have a confirmation of identity, because it's not just the treatment. Of course, there is the shape of the filling and the shape of the treatment itself, but it's not just the treatment. The overall shape of the pulp canals, the pulp chamber, the shape of the roots, even the trabeculae pattern, or if you can see the edge of the sinus, all those things help in confirming identity. So it's not just the treatment, it's also the normal findings which are unique to that person, such as the pattern of the trabeculae or the pattern of the edges of the sinus. All this can provide unique identification. So it can still be helpful only if you have a small radiograph.
So I think question of the Jaffer and many other also answered by this. I just want to take another question. Madam, you can also read the question if you find any question. If anyone in between has a direct question, they can raise hand also. I'll allow their unmuting, then they can ask.
How can we differentiate between milk teeth and permanent teeth in case of mixed dentition? That is a very basic thing. That is why I said we require basic knowledge of dentistry. This is taught in our undergraduation when we are still in first, second, third year becoming a dentist. This is taught. It's a very basic thing for dentists. So there are many features how we can differentiate between milk tooth and permanent tooth. It's the morphologically, you can say, based on so many things, the size, shape, number of cusps and groove. I cannot even count it right now, because it's a very obvious. Being a dentist, we can say if this is a milk teeth or a permanent tooth. The color of the two teeth is different. The shapes are different. The number is different. We in milk we have 20 milk teeth and we have 32 adult teeth. So in milk teeth, we don't have premolars. So there are so many things. The number of cusps are there. The morphology of each and every tooth is different. So we are able to identify whether it is a permanent or milk deciduous teeth. Also in mixed dentition, we know that it is a particular age range in which the child will have a mixed dentition. So it is somewhere between 6 and 12 years where, you know, roughly if the child will have a mixed dentition in this period. So we know what to expect basically when we are observing the mouth.
Yeah, Kritika Mishra wants to ask, do canine index is helpful for the sex determination?
Again, it is helpful and it can only be a circumstantial evidence. It cannot be a reliable or it cannot stand on its own for sex determination. But it can definitely guide and it can help as a circumstantial evidence.
Herman, I'm just unmuting you. You can ask your question. Herman Singh.
Yes, sir. Sir, I just wanted to ask you that in a manifestation where you have multiple teeth, apart from the normal number of teeth, either it be the base teeth has mentioned 20 numbers or be it the adult teeth that is 32 number. I don't know the exact terminology for that manifestation. But the question is, if we have more than 32 teeth in the mouth and then in that manifestation, how the age can be determined?
So you are talking about supernumerary teeth. Many people have that extra, teeth in their mouth or extra tooth in their mouth, which is a unique finding, and it helps us when we are identifying that person because it is a unique finding and it is not very common. But it doesn't affect age estimation methods in any way. We still do age estimation using our regular techniques.
Yeah,
Seja
wants to ask a question.
Seja, yes, my question to you, ma'am, is like, given the situation in India where mostly the patient's dental record is not maintained, or as you said correctly, like it is mostly like handover to the patient itself at times. In case wherein we just find the skull of a person, how does the PI is maintained? How do we do the personal identification wherein you just find the skull of a person?
So in those cases, if obviously we use other techniques, if the someone is claiming the body and there is a missing person but there is no dental records, we can use DNA. Right, so you don't have to do dental identification all the time. You can use DNA if there is no dental records, but there is someone claiming the body. And in India, practically speaking, that will be the first thing which will be done if someone is claiming the body. But if there is no one claiming the body and you want to do an ID, obviously you will not have any comparative record because no one is claiming the body as well. So in those cases, we do a profiling. As I said earlier, we do a sex determination, we do age determination, and all those, if there is any other finding, unique finding we can see, we give those details to the police. So for example, we find a skull, we do the analysis, we give a report to the police that this is someone between 30 to 35 year old male. So then the police goes in their records and check if any 30 to 35 year old male has been reported missing in the past few months in that region. And then if they have a few options that okay, these 7 men were reported missing by their families, then we do comparative identification with all those. So for narrowing down, we will first do a profiling.
Yeah, Dr. Shraddha Malik wants to some question. I'm just handing over to Dr. Shraddha Malik. Madam, you can ask the question. Her question, can an oral pathologist give his opinion as a forensic odontologist in any unidentified body during an autopsy being done in a civil hospital as a government employee? 209. Time is 209.
Is it? One second.
209.
Given the... No, 209 is...
3-4 question is there. Shraddha Malik question.
By whom?
Shraddha Malik.
Shraddha Malik. Sorry, I can't find it. Can you read the question again?
Can an oral pathologist give his opinion as a forensic odontologist in any unidentified body during an autopsy being done in a civil hospital as a government employee?
A oral pathologist who has some kind of experience or training in forensic odontology can definitely do. In fact, our Indian Evidence Act, it says that an expert is a person who has the knowledge of their subject by training or by experience or by his skills. So it is a very broad definition, and oral pathologist can testify or can, but you should be able to go later on, appear in court and defend what you have written. So there should be some kind of training for in forensic odontology, which will make it easier to be acceptable later on in court that you are trained in forensic odontology.
Yeah, Dr. Shweta Sharma wants to ask, are we using software-based forensic facial approximation? Have manual and the software-based method been compared?
Yes, we can use software-based methods. However, as of now, it is quite expensive, these softwares. So it is not being used as of now, but we can use, and in more developed countries such as US, UK, Germany, etc., in European countries, they are using software-based methods for reconstruction. As of now, I don't think any comparative study is being done. I will have to research. I'm not sure if any comparative study is being done. We are in the process of setting up a lab in our department for doing software-based facial reconstructions right now. So as of now, I know in India, no one is doing this software-based reconstruction.
Yeah, Dr. Rohan wants to ask a question. As per the Indian Evidence Act, when a person goes missing, as is unheard for the 7 years, the person is considered dead. My question is, such a case, what is the date of death recorded for the death certificate?
So it will be the, according to the investigation is carried out, it could be the date the person was reported missing, or it will depend on the investigation. If there are further clues and evidences, then it will be based on that. And I think Gorya sir will be able to answer it better.
So I have
one second, let Gorya sir answer this now.
Yes.
Whenever the dead body is brought, it is the duty of the police to go for all these things. Usually they will say when the body is dead, but once they can't determine, they bring it to forensic pathologist. Then forensic pathologist, after examining, usually gives a range of the time. And so the death of time will be during that period range of time.
Yeah. Aditya wants to ask, working as an oral pathologist at Civil Hospital in Haryana, am I right person to go for assisting autopsy during routine postmortem if required, or give opinion as a forensic odontologist?
Yes,
definitely you can go. I mean, it depends on the forensic medicine people, if they are willing to have you over there as a part of a team, because it's not a very casual thing to do. You know, it's a legal process. There are confidentiality issues related to this. So if the medical officer who is in charge, or the forensic medicine person, head of department, whoever is in charge, if they allow you, also the investigating officer should be allowing you, because the IO is the in charge of the case. He's like the king of the case. So if he allows and the medical people allow, then definitely you can go and assist. It will help you in gaining experience as well.
Yeah, Dr. Rohan wants to ask a question. Dr. Rohan, over to you.
Gorya sir, your answer was fine, but it is true. When a body is found, then we can find out the approximate time since death, post-mortem interval. But my question is, when a body is not found, and it's been 7 years since that, and now, as per the Indian Evidence Act, now the death certificate has to be issued. So what will be the date of death recorded in such cases? Because it will have serious implications as to 7 saal se unka, claims are pending, and
So in that case, it is mentioned in the law that is, since that last person has not been heard of.
Yeah.
Since the last person not has been heard of 7 years after that.
So the date will be 7 years past first reporting that such and such person has been missing?
Has not been heard of. then only all the benefits that will accrue.
7 saal ke baad. Okay. And suppose, sir, let's say 2-3 mahine baad, 7 saal death certificate issue ho gaya, 2-3 mahino baad koi you know body identify ho jati hai. And suppose carbon dating se pata bhi chal gaya ki when this person actually died, and let's say missing hone ke actually 6 mahine ke baad ye person mar gaya, then 6.5 saal ka to sir benefit chala gaya na family ka.
But the body is identified, no?
Body has been identified. The question is about the
Dr. Rohan, the part I'll like to answer here.
Yep.
There is a matter of trial. If someone wants to get the benefit of last 6 years, so he can go for the particular claimant authority that why the things has been not with the relevant
number.
Second, the is a like correctly said by Gorya sir and the Himlata madam, the reporting is very, very important. If someone is missing, like, see, if I said to my family I'm going to Saudi Arabia for work, and continuously I'm doing a work, or I'm chatting with the family, or someone who is kidnapped me chatting on my behalf, as one case discussed by the construction worker, that lady killed and the boyfriend was chatting, and the children were in a like situation that the father is alive and he is sending the money. So it should depend upon the circumstances and where you want to prove the things. And legal standing is completely different than the scientific standing.
Yeah, I think this matter will be open for open in, definitely, for challenge in the court.
Yeah, it's open for the discussion, and it's depend upon the how the case has been reported, and how the investigating officer is doing the investigation.
Exactly. This particular case will fall in rarest of rare categories, I guess.
Correct.
Yeah, fine.
So, thank you, madam, for the wonderful session and the answering all the questions.
Thank you, sir.
I might have missed a few questions, so in advance I'm just saying a sorry. But tomorrow I'll send one link where you can type your questions and take all the question into the discussion. We'll try to take all the question, and if you are not able to take all the question in the panel discussion, we'll write a question answer in a blog form and share to the all participants. All 496 participants will share through the email.
Okay.